So the big news is I'm a wizard now. Check this out, look, full goblet. All right. Empty goblet. Replete Poculum. This is some Harry Potter merchandise that you can't get anymore. It must be about 20 years old, this thing. And it's got a really cool mechanism, so, well, I had to laser cut a 2D version, didn't I? I was pretty confident I knew how this thing worked. Like, you can see the walls are suspiciously thick and there's something strange going on at the bottom there, but I cut one in half anyway, just to be sure. And so my 2D model is based on this outline here, but you'll notice it doesn't work at all. When I fill it up, the water doesn't get into the sides. And actually, on closer inspection, look, there's a little hole on the outer rim of the goblet. So I need to put a little hole in mine as well. And once again, I've made the classic 3D to 2D conversion error. In 3D, the side walls form one continuous chamber, but in 2D, it's now two separate chambers. It's also a problem for bell siphons. Will I never learn? So with a hole on both sides, when I fill up the goblet, air is able to escape from the side chambers, and so they fill up with liquid as well. So you drink it off. The great part is, as long as you keep your finger over those holes, the water will remain hidden in those side chambers. I mean, it's not hidden in this version, unless you're also 2D and you're coplanar with it. But anyway, it means you can stop the goblet refilling until you deliver the refilling charm. Replete Poculum. Refilling charms do appear in the Harry Potter series, by the way. Harry uses it in the Half-Blood Prince, but we don't know the actual incantation because Harry cast the charm non-verbally. So this uses a similar principle to the Assassin's Teapot. By putting your finger over one hole, you prevent the water from escaping from the only remaining hole. It doesn't work in exactly the same way as the Assassin's Teapot. Like, they both rely on the fact that for water to escape from a container, air needs to be able to get in to replace it. That's a consequence of atmospheric pressure. I won't go into the details of that because I cover it in the Assassin's Teapot video, but it's something you probably have an intuition for anyway from the times you've played with a straw as a kid. But the Harry Potter goblet and the Assassin's Teapot differ in the way they prevent air getting into the chamber. If a container has just one hole, that has to be the exit hole for the water and the entry hole for the air. And that is possible so long as the hole is big enough. The air kind of chaotically bubbles past the water. But if that one hole is so small that surface tension becomes important, then you do need a second hole for the water to be able to escape. And that's the working principle of the Assassin's Teapot. But the way the Harry Potter goblet stops air getting in is more like the way a chicken waterer works. So look, this thing is full of water. Some of it's coming into the bottom there. And as water is removed via drinking, this is how chickens actually drink, I believe. Every chicken carries this little cup with them and they scoop the water out. Anyway, as the water's removed, more water from the container moves down to replace it. And the level of the water never really changes, which is also quite magical. So here's the 2D version, and look, as the chicken drinks, air bubbles through, and the level remains the same. So just like the Assassin's Teapot, this water can't fall out of the container because air can't get in to replace it. But unlike the Assassin's Teapot, it's not surface tension that's stopping the air getting in. Instead, it's the fact that water is more dense than air, and that creates a kind of plug. Like, the air would have to somehow push this bit of water down to be able to get in the thing. Like, if that happened, that really would be magic. Ventus. The goblet works in the same way. Air isn't able to get down and under that barrier because there is water in the way. Actually, this is how chickens drink, I believe. They've got a little syringe in their mouths and it comes out, and then this top, like I noticed this cool thing while I was filling the 2D chicken waterer. The stream is touching both walls of the container, which creates a seal, which means we now have a fixed volume of air inside here. So as the water level rises, the stream must bulge upwards until it breaks, and then the cycle continues. Another issue with going from 3D to 2D is the volume available for the hidden chambers. Like, if adding hidden chambers to my 2D version was to double the width of the goblet, then those hidden chambers would be able to hold exactly the same volume as the central chamber. But consider this top-down view of a 3D goblet. If adding a hidden chamber here were to double the width of the goblet, well, the hidden chamber would have three times the capacity of the central chamber. So I ended up making my hidden chambers quite a bit thicker than the goblet ones. By the way, if you like the Assassin's Teapot, I've had something in the works for a little while that I think you'd be really interested in. Something you can own. So if you want to make sure you hear the announcement, consider clicking the notification bell. It should be one of my next few videos. So I've got my own laser cutter now. I've been like just cutting loads of stuff and just trying different things. And I've come up with this thing that I want to show you. It's not related to the goblet at all, but it's a cool 2D water thing. So Jack Bull asked me the question, how does water drain? And I thought about it for a while and I realized actually I don't know the answer, which is to say, like if you pull the plug out, the water that comes out the plug hole, where does it come from? You know, does the water drain from the bottom layer first, or does it drain from like the cylinder immediately above the plug hole, or is it something in between? We know that if the body of water has any kind of rotation to begin with, it'll end up swirling around the plug hole. But what if there is no rotation? I think we need a 2D version. Sacare cum lumine. Well, that's not desperately helpful. If only we had some neutrally buoyant bees from a previous video. Now, because this is 2D, we definitely don't have rotation, but we also have like boundary layer effects because of these two large transparent walls. So this might not be a great model of what happens in 3D, but I still want to see it. So it looks to me like the water is coming evenly from all directions. I hope that answers your question, Jack. I also wondered about like if the container was funnel shaped, how different would that be? It's easier to see in this one that there's a boundary layer effect. The beads seem slower right next to the sloped walls. There's this video effect in Premiere Pro editing software called Echo. It leaves a trail when things move across the screen. So look, if I turn that on here, how cool is that? You can get a sense of like the speed of the flow in different places and the direction of it. It's quite mesmerizing. Watching it fill up is pretty cool too. Drowning by yourself, now you wanna blame me. Like you have no option. I didn't realize this Premiere feature existed when I made the convection viewer video, so I really want to show you that now. How cool is it that you can see like little eddy currents that form, little vortices that separate from the main flow? That would be really hard to see without the effect applied. Link in the card in the description if you want to see that video in full. You know, life is full of little annoyances, and it's important to make peace with that fact. But at the same time, I'm the sort of nerd that thinks about optimization a lot. Like, is there a system I can put in place now, or something I can do that will remove annoyances and friction in the future? As a result, I have all sorts of crazy systems in my life. And thanks to the sponsor of this video, Incogni, there is one really easy thing that you can do to remove annoyances in the future and improve your security at the same time. The annoyances in question are marketing phone calls, junk mail, and spam emails. The reason you get these annoyances in your life is because of companies called data brokers. They collect data about you and then sell that data onto marketers. Data brokers must delete your data if you ask them to. The problem is there are hundreds of them and they all want to be asked in a different specific way. So Incogni have done all that work up front to figure out how those companies operate. All you have to do is give them permission to act on your behalf, and then they just take care of the rest. They contact them all, they deal with the rejections, and you can go onto your portal and you can see, look, these are all the companies that no longer have my data. And the reason it improves security is because data breaches are becoming more and more common. And when a data broker has a breach, that's loads of personal information about you that is now in the hands of a criminal. If that sounds like something you want to try, then the promo on this one is really good. If you go to incogni.com/science, you'll get 60% off their annual plan. The link is also in the description, so check out Incogni today. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, don't forget to hit subscribe, and the algorithm thinks you'll enjoy this video next.